Well, hello and a big warm welcome to the Matrix Match Fishing Masterclass. And believe me, we've got some masters for you. Throughout the course of this DVD, the Matrix team is, without any shadow of doubt, second to none. Who's up? Well, we've got a former Park Dean Master and a former UK champion, Grant Albutt. We've also got the current reigning Fishermania champion, Andy Geldart. We've got former Fishermania champion as well, Warren Martin. And joining me in the studio, Match This champion, and me old mucker from the Midlands, Les Thompson.
Hiya, Rob.
Les, how are we all?
Fantastic, yeah, Rob.
Good season.
Oh, well, it's been good so far, yeah, to be fair. Been close, same as a lot of the Matrix lads, so we're all close to getting back to these finals again, is what we all chase, so that's what we're all after.
Well, it's a mega competitive season out there at the moment, and all the boys are out there all the time, just putting their tips and tactics through their paces. Who's up first? Well, let's get out on the bank and have a look at Warren Martin, who was over at Chestnut Pool.
Hi, I'm Warren Martin. You join me here today at Chestnut Pools near Biggleswade. We're hopefully going to catch some carp on method feeders and pellet feeders cast into the island. There's a few key points that you get asked time and time again about these methods, so hopefully we can clear some of those up today. Let's get started. Two most essential things when feeder fishing to islands are how tight to the island you decide to fish, and then once you've decided that, how accurate you are in doing that. There's many things to consider. I've never been to this venue before today. It's very, very coloured, so I'm assuming that the fish will go into the shallow water so I can cast tight to the island, as tight as I can. Not definitely going to be right, but I'll start fishing tight. If you're getting lots of liners and indications but not many fish, then you can start moving your way back into the deeper water. As a general rule, if it's coloured, the fish will go into the shallow water tight to the island. If it's clearer, they'll feel a bit safer in slightly deeper water, so you can come further away. Obviously, I've decided that. I now need to clip up tight to the island. It's just a case of casting out, getting closer and closer and closer. Once you get to the point you want, clip up. The thing to remember is, before the match or before your session, you're casting with a bomb or an empty feeder. Once you load the feeder up, you're adding weight to it, so it will always go that little bit further. So before the start, don't clip up as tight as you want to fish. Clip up a little bit short, and then the extra weight with the lead will take, with the feed, will take it that little bit further. Let's get clipped up. Right, we're going to clip up now. It's probably a 40-45 yard cast, and the wind is awful, so I'm making my excuses now before we start, but it's quite a good whack. But we'll get clipped up just to the left of some sedges on the far bank. That's probably a metre, metre and a half short, so we'll just take a bit more line off. Clip up. Remember, we don't want to get absolutely tight now because the extra weight of the bait on the feeder. But hopefully with that little bit of extra line, that should now put us maybe half a metre short of the island. Let's see where it is. Right, that's probably just about bang on, just another 600mm or so line, and that'll now be perfect and ready to fish. Right. We're clipped up now, we know where we're casting. There's still one more thing to consider, and that's where and how you hit the clip. It's no good hitting the clip right back behind your head because you'll obviously be short of the feature, but similarly, it's no good hitting the clip with your rod straight in front because you're going to end up moving the feeder when you're then pulling your rod back to get it on the rests and moving a method feeder or a pellet feeder. You've just wasted a cast, it won't work. So what you need to try and do is hit the clip in exactly the same place each time, which leaves you just enough line to allow you to follow the rod down and put it on the rest without moving the feeder. So it's just a case of getting in a routine, really, of smoothly casting, hitting the clip in the same place, which means punching the feeder hard enough to make sure you can hit the clip in the same place, ideally at sort of a 45 degree angle, and then you can just simply follow it down onto the rest. So let's see if we can get it right. So good punch, hit the clip and down. Feeder's in the perfect spot, rod on the rest, nothing can move now. Started on the method feeder today. Your two options really are method feeder or pellet feeder. I tend to prefer a method feeder when I think I'm going to catch a lot of fish, they want a lot of feed and they're going to come to the feeder quite quickly. I always feel a method feeder, once it's in the water, is fishing sooner than a pellet feeder. That can obviously, a pellet feeder in that case, can work to your advantage in colder weather, when you're waiting longer for bites, when you don't want to put quite so much feed in, sort of more winter, autumn time, smaller fish, F1s, the pellet feeder just is a bit more refined, really. But I think we're going to catch plenty of fish today. It's coloured, we're looking for big fish, so I want to put a lot of bait in. And the fish, I think, will come at the feeder quite quick. So I think on days like today, the method feeder is the better option, really. There we go, a nice mirror carp. Second chuck on the method feeder. Right, we mentioned method feeders and pellet feeders, and I mentioned that the method feeder is a more positive, quicker way of fishing when we're looking for lots of fish. Obviously with the method feeder, the bait disperses quite quick. It will spread over an area, not a massive area, but it will leave the feeder, spread around, leave your bait on top. For days when we're catching lots of fish and the fish are homing in on the feeder, I think method feeders are the way to go. To help that, the way I load my feeder, make sure that my hook bait's always very near the top of the pile. Basically, I just put a very small amount of feed in the mould, then I place my hook bait in, and then I fill it up. So when we then turn the feeder out of the mould upside down, my hook bait is right near the top of that pile, and the fish will be able to get to it really quickly. On good days, I think that's the way to go. The pellet feeder comes into its own on days when it's a little bit harder, it might be colder, we might be fishing for less fish, because what it produces is a much smaller, neater, compact pile of bait. It takes a bit longer to work and come out of the feeder, but once it's working, it is that little bit neater and there isn't the spread of bait. So days when the fish are a little bit cagey, don't want loads of bait, a tiny little neat pile with your hook bait in it, I think is better than the method, which is a bit more positive. It's very easy to swap and change between the two using the Evolution system. We just slide the rubber off, pull the line out of the slot in the back of the feeder, pull everything through, and then repeat the process with the new feeder. Drop everything through. Line into the slot in the back of the feeder. Tail rubber back on. Pull it through. In 10 seconds, you're now fishing with the pellet feeder. Got a 4-inch hook length of 018 power micron. Some people fish 2 or 3 inches. Some people think 6 is better. My personal preference is 4. So 2 to 6 inch hook length, basically. We've got a size 14 carp bander with the bait aligner. And all we do with that is use the pellet bander, open the band up, pop a pellet on, and we're away, ready to load up and fish. Just a quick mention about preparation, and this goes for any style of match fishing, not just method feeder fishing. It's always best to be prepared, and a little bit of time, a couple of evenings a week, tying hook lengths up in a match can save you so much time. As I said, I prefer to tie mine 4 inches. You've got the different pegs for different lengths. There's one bang on 100 mil, ready tied 4 inch hook length with a baiter liner. Takes 5 seconds to get out and get your back fishing straight away. Before we cast out again, we'll just have a closer look at the baiter liner. It's something that's been taken from the specimen carp fishing world. Basically, you can see here, it just creates an angle where it comes off the hook that increases the gape of the hook and the amount of hook that's available to hook the fish, basically. You can see from the fish we've caught, they're all properly hooked, and that's purely because all the hook is free to hook them. It basically just kicks it off at the angle it should do, and it's a lot easier to tie than a hair rig. Right, probably the most important thing about method feeder and pellet feeder fishing is getting the bait right. The general rule of thumb is it wants to be on the drier side. As soon as you over wet your ground bait or over soak your pellets, they just won't bind together properly. Each ground bait, each pellet's different really, so it's trial and error, but always go on the drier side. You can always add more water if you need to, but you can't take it out. Pellets, with these 2mm Vandenine pellets, I just know from experience that they need very little time to be right. So basically I just put some in the tub, totally cover them in water, and they literally need 30 seconds. So while they're soaking, we'll do the ground bait. Again, drier is better. Don't need a lot. We'll just put that in the bowl. Traditionally with ground bait, you add a little bit of water, mix it a little bit more. But with this krill, it takes on a lot of water. So I basically give it a fairly good amount. Give it all a stir in. So at this point, it's too wet, but if you're doing this before you're tackling up, it'll dry out. Then all we need to do is put it through the riddle before we start, and it'll be perfect. The pellets will be done now. So literally just drain all the water off of them. Again, you're doing this before you're fishing, so these will now have half an hour or so to sit. And by the time we start fishing, they'll be perfectly sort of tacky but not soaked, basically. Right, we've left it for 10 minutes now to settle, and it should now all be ready to go. You can see the pellets have taken on a bit of water. They're not completely soaked, but what they are is now sticky enough to mould into a ball and go round the feeder. So they're now ready. As you see, they'll break down again, so they're still complete pellets rather than gone into a paste. Stick those in there. So that's pellets ready to go. Now we just need to riddle the ground bait. So very simply, riddle on the bowl.
put it through the riddle, push the lumps through. And what we're left with there is a dryish mix that will go into a lovely ball, and that's not too sticky. It will come off the feeder. It won't get stuck in the mould. That's absolutely perfect. It's as easy as that. Right, so we've now got the baits ready, and that was the easy bit, because now we've got to decide what we're actually going to use. You can fish pellets on their own. If you do that, you tend to have to fish a pellet hook bait. If we use the ground bait on the feeder, that gives us the option of fishing dead maggots, corn, mini boilies, other baits. But I do generally feel when we're putting pellets around the feeder, it makes sense to fish pellet on the hook. There's no right or wrong. There's no hard and fast rules. One day it can be pellets, one day it can be ground bait. Today I've started on pellets around the feeder with a 6mm on the hook. Had a lot of liners, indications, a couple of fish. But I was getting a lot of liners for the number of proper bites I was getting. So I've changed over to ground bait, and almost immediately all the indications stopped. So that immediately shows you that it is a pellet day. It's not always that simple. It is trial and error. You can use a 50-50 mix of the two. Some days that'll be the way to go. But basically have some ground bait, have some pellets, have another tin maybe with a mixture of the two, and just see which brings most indications, most action. Right, just a quick mention about loading the feeder. Fairly easy process with the squeeze and feed moulds. The only thing really you need to think about is whereabouts in the feeder you want your hook bait to be. With a hard bait, such as a hard pellet or a boilie, you can get your bait quite close to the top of the pile on the feeder. The problem with a softer bait, like dead maggot or corn, you need it to be slightly more in the middle of the ball, and that's purely because when we're compressing it, a softer bait nearer the bottom of the mould, i.e. the top of the feeder, you can squash them off the hook. So with a softer bait, I would probably fill the mould at least halfway before I put a soft bait in it and then top it up. With a harder bait, such as a hard pellet, I'd literally put a dusting of pellets in the bottom, then the hook bait, then the rest of it. Because it's a hard bait, it's not going to damage when you squeeze it. Then you're left with your loaded method feeder, and we can just see our hook pellet very, very close to the top of the pile. So within seconds of that going in the water, a fish would be able to get to that. With a pellet feeder, same as the method feeder, ideally we want our hook bait as close to the front of the feeder as we can, so it's accessible as early as possible, really. So it's a case, fill the feeder up just level with the surface of it, give it a squeeze, put our hook pellet on top, scoop through again, good firm squeeze this time, and there it is, ready to go. And within seconds our pellet will be on the top, falling out the feeder, ready for a fish to get to. Something to consider to make fishing easier is getting the correct rod and reel for the situation that you're facing. Today we've got a chuck of about 30 metres, so I'm using the Mark II 10-foot carp master. Nice and strong in the butt to punch the feeder and land big carp that sort of are averaging 7 or 8 pound. Nice and short, so when we go to net the fish, they're within netting range. Just an ideal rod for this sort of fishing, really. Matched it with a 4000 size Aquos. Fits perfectly with the rod, really. Not overly heavy, but powerful enough
wide enough spool to make the casting easy. And we've matched that with 10 pound in the new Carp Master sinking mono. 10 pound sounds quite heavy, which it is. It's obviously more than strong enough for the fish we're catching, but this particular line is very soft, very supple. So even on a 4,000 size reel, we can quite happily use it and be confident that, it's more than strong enough to land anything we're going to hook. It sounds obvious, but one of the most important things about feeder fishing is to get yourself comfortable. Also where you angle the rod. There's a common trend at the moment for some reason to almost point the rod at the feeder. I don't like to do that because you're clipped up, you hook a fish and it goes, you've got very little give or leeway. I like to come round slightly at an angle just to give myself that bit of room to, play a hooked fish. The other thing to consider is whether you hold your rod or whether you have your rod on a butt rest. If it's a hard day, say winter time, and you're waiting a long time between bites, then I would use a butt rest just because it's more comfortable, you can move around, you can do things without affecting the rod. Today, when we're catching a lot of fish and getting a lot of bites, I'm not loose feeding on other lines, so I don't need to do anything else. So it's easy just to have the rod across your knee and hold it. Telescopic feeder arm can be adjusted wherever you want it. A decent sized rod rest head. What we were talking about earlier about dropping short, maybe going tighter, with a rest of this size, you can actually do that via the rest. One cast, if you want to drop it shorter, you can stop it and have it there. You want to go tight, you can stop it and have it there. So that just gives you a little bit of movement without having to clip up, unclip, change things. With the mega feeder arm, there's no situation basically that we can't get comfortable and correctly set. For still water fishing, we're obviously always going to want the head lower down if we're fishing with a butt rest, or knee height if we're fishing across the knee. It will move horizontally quite easily, and by adjusting the top arm, if we were fishing on a river, you can get it to whatever height you want to get your line out of the water. There's also a cam lock to extend even further if you want to. So whatever situation, wherever you're fishing with this arm, you can get your rod correctly set. Was my last cast of the day. Hopefully a few of the hints and tips I've given you can help you go out and catch a few like this yourselves.
Well, there's Warren over at Chestnut Pool, and Les, he certainly catches a few, doesn't he, that lad?
Oh, he knows his stuff. Warren really is an excellent method feeder fisherman, and he does really well on that Norfolk circuit with that method, you know, and as we saw in that clip, I think he caught a lot of fish in that session, so...
Yeah, it didn't look brilliant conditions either as well. It was quite cold then.
No, it was testing, and it was quite early in the year. The carp had just started moving, and he mentioned they wanted to switch between a pellet feeder and a method feeder. You know, and he obviously had a good day's fishing.
Certainly in situations like that, attention to detail is a massive point. And one of the things that I picked up was one of the first things he said, actually, which was about the accuracy issue. You know, when you're setting up and you're clipping up, you've got to bear in mind the difference between a full feeder and an empty feeder.
Absolutely. If you notice, there were quite a few casts where he had one cast where he dropped within 2 metres, then he came back, another cast got within 1.5 metres. Then he got to within a range where he felt it would be comfortable that when he loaded his feeder up, it would land dead tight to that island in that shallow water which he spoke about, which he thought he could catch those fish in if it coloured up. He also spoke about he knew where to drop it back in the deeper water. But just by holding it back from that little bit of a distance from the island, say a foot and a half, once that feeder's loaded, the compression on the rod, the stretch in the line, all takes its momentum just that little bit further forward. And you see lots of anglers, when they set up, they throw in dead tight with an empty feeder. They pick the rod back up, they clip it round, start the match, boom, squirrels in the trees, and it looks like it. That's why we see all these lovely decorations when we turn up at lots of venues.
You know, beginning of the match as well, you want to fish as quickly as possible, as accurately as possible. You want a good start, don't you? You need to get that confidence boost straight away.
Well, exactly. You know, you've only got a limited time to set up, so you don't want to be setting up again, you know, immediately after you've just started fishing. And there is a big difference in between, like an unloaded feeder and a loaded feeder. So we'll just quickly have a look at that. I mean, he was filling up his mould, and he's, obviously there's the hook, there's the boilie which he was using, or the pellet, and he was pushing right down. So it was quite a well-loaded feeder. I mean, this one was initially 30 gram, but if you actually feel the weight of that now, that's heading more towards a 40 gram plus. So when that rod, as you see, when it casts, it compresses the one way, but all that has to transfer as it reaches the point of the island where he's actually landing his feeder. The momentum is going to carry on, and it's going to land on the bank if he doesn't hold it back just that little bit shorter when he's doing that lining up and sorting out where he wants to clip for his first cast.
And, you know, watching the lads on the UK Champ circuit as well, you can see the guys that are always rising to the top, and the difference is that little bit of attention to detail. It's
absolutely
that makes a good match angler. Everyone can catch fish, but doing it consistently and with accuracy.
Absolutely. You could just see everything was in the right position. As he cast, he knew where it was going to go. The rod came back to the same position every time. That was the key to keep everything tight. You hit a rhythm, and that is the key to feeder fishing as well, finding a rhythm. And Warren was into that rhythm straight away. Once he'd found where he wanted that feeder to be, he made sure he kept it there every time.
Now, Les, the other thing that I picked up from that was another thing that's massively important, that is speed. Being able to change that rig from the method feeder to the pellet feeder, that's a massive advantage, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, speed in match fishing, if you go out, you're going to get the most out of 5 hours or 6 hours, what some matches are. If you can, if you get more out of that, more time in the water, the more chances you're going to get a bite. I mean, he was using one rod. Now, time when you're setting up is important. If you've got to set up three rods, that's three rods you've got to cast to the same spot. You can't always guarantee that you're going to get in exactly the same spot. But with that evolution system that he was using, he can, and he can switch. So instead of having three rods set up, one with an open ender, one with a pellet feeder, one with a method feeder, thanks to that just little clip and that system where everything can be removed and put back on the line, within a matter, I think he said 10 seconds. Mm. I mean, 10 seconds is next to nothing. How long would it take you to set?
Well, you can't get your scissors out of your box within 10 seconds.
You can't, no. By the time you bit it off, tied a knot, set back up again, then he's got to cast back, and then he's got to go through the whole process of that casting again. That's shorter, because he just shortened his line, but not with that system. So we'll just have a little bit of a closer look at that. And as Warren showed, it all comes down just through a hole in the back of a method feeder. You just move the tail rubber, like that. Remove the line from the groove. I mean, that's seconds.
It's massively simple, isn't it?
It's just so simple.
Just have a little look at that. So the key to it then is purely, really, just the fact that it's got the hole in it. So as is always the case, the most complex of problems is solved with the simplest
and
of answers.
There's lots of venues around the country still favour an inline system. Mm. I mean, if you're using an elasticated system, it's quite easy to just take it off. As you know, you've seen elasticated methods.
Yeah.
But with an inline system, it's so easy to just take it away like that. A standard inline feeder, it's stuck on the line. You've got to cut the line. So you need just that little groove there, as you saw, it just pops out.
Simple as anything.
It's simple as anything. You just take your time, just a little bit of patience. If you don't want to dull the point of your hook, I mean, that one's removed. He switched over to a pellet feeder, because he said, like, he favoured it more in winter, and it was a little bit colder, those conditions, and you could see the leaves were just coming onto the trees, and I just feed the hook back through, like so. It's all nice and covered, don't dull the point. The feeder bead's already popped through straight away, so you just trap that back off and just pull the line gently back into the groove, slide your rubber back down. I mean, we're not even on the bank, and we've swapped.
Incredibly quick.
So he's gone from a method feeder to a pellet feeder. I mean, these have been around now for a couple of years. Mm. There's lots of anglers using them. There's still lots of anglers that are still using old traditional ones. But this is the real big advantage, that swapping. I mean, if you wanted to think, well, I've got too much bait in there now. I've gone from the method feeder. I've gone from the pellet feeder. I'll swap it over to an open ender or a bomb. Same again. Just quickly remove that. Tail rubber, take everything else, nice and gentle, feeder bead pops out, hook lens out, nice and safe. And you pick up the lead clip. I mean,
So the system works for all sorts of methods.
It's totally universal. I mean, we've got everything that you want to do for fishing the bottom of your swim with a rod and line. It's all on one setup.
You've not got to worry about taking it out of the clip like that. Bang, it's on.
There's three rods that you need to have set up.
Yeah.
But he's on one rod in the same place all the time. So we just take that lead clip. And these are nice and safe as well. They're nice, free running, just into the groove. And it's all just a simple system. Just feed it through nice and gentle because you don't want to damage the line. Like that. That's on. And you just gently just move that to the one side on the clip. On with the feeder. Same again. I mean, how easy is that? It's just so simple. Just nice, safe, free running. If you did lose a fish and it got snagged up, it's going to get rid of the feeder. It's not going to run around with that around the lake.
Yeah.
Perfect, just how these fishery owners like it these days. It doesn't get any simpler.
Well, some brilliant tips and tactics there from our man in the studio and, of course, Warren Martin out on the bank. And we're going back out on the bank again, this time to Moorfield Farm, where we've got Fishermania champion Andy Geldart looking at how best and also when to go down the edge.
We're here today at Moorfields Farm Fishery and I'm going to be going through with you how to catch in the margins in the last hour of a match. Generally that's a make or break situation and it's a difference between success and failure. I'm going to be answering some questions today on how to catch in that final hour of a match. So how I generally choose where I'm going to fish in a margin, it depends on what cover I've got and where it is in my peg. Like today I've got a nice sedge down to my left and a platform as well, so that's giving some good cover for big carp to come and lie in. It doesn't necessarily have to be a sedge or a platform. Sometimes it could be a bed of reeds, could be lilies. There's all sorts of different things that can hold fish, but generally you need to be fishing next to some sort of cover to hold the fish. It just gives them that little bit more confidence when margin fishing. It makes all the difference. And like today, I'm coming up next to this sedge now and I've got 3 foot of water maybe, which this time of year is absolutely perfect because we're still in spring and it gives a little bit more confidence because of the depth of fishing. So now having plumbed my margin line, I'm going to concentrate for generally 3 hours of the match. It'll be out here. So today I've got an island in front of me at 16 metres, which I'm feeding a line at 13 metres. And then usually 2 hours to go, I'll look at feeding my margin line. Sometimes I may feed it a little early. If I look around the lake and there's anglers already catching in the margin early on, I possibly may feed it a little earlier. But in my opinion, I think you can get a bit preoccupied in fishing the margin too early because the fish come in and they're not overly confident. So I find it better to start feeding it with 2 hours to go, give them an hour's confidence, and then the last hour, hopefully they go in and we'll catch a lot of fish when they're really feeding confidently because it's the light's dropping, it's the last hour of the match. And I think that is personally the best time to go down there.
We'll be right back.
we've got 2 hours left now and I'm going to look into feeding my margin swim. I like to use a mixture of fishery pellets and sweet corn. Just a third of a pot full of 6 mil pellets, a third of a pot full of micro pellets, and I'll finish the pot off with a handful of corn. I like to feed the big baits down the margin to keep everything nailed onto the bottom. If you feed smaller baits, it gets wafted up in the water, fish come in at all depths and you struggle with line bites, foul up fish. This way it keeps everything pinned to the bottom and hopefully eliminate the line bites. I'm going to feed this margin now religiously every 20 minutes for the next hour, which will give me 4 pots of bait, and I will follow the 4th pot in with the rig. When targeting carp in the margins, it's important that you've got a pole that's up to the job. Last thing you want to be doing is going into the last hour, starting hooking fish down the margins and your pole's not up to it, or you're not confident with the pole that you're using. That's why I like to use Matrix Nemesis pole. Some people prefer using a margin pole specific for margin fishing, but I'm that confident in using my Nemesis. It's light, it's strong, and it's more than capable of catching fish up to 20 pounds. When we're catching these fish in the margin in the last hour, we could be playing catch up in the match. So it's all about getting in there quick, getting the fish out quick, you know, and the Nemesis pole is more than capable of doing that. It's strong enough. And as long as it's paired up with the right elastic, you're going to be able to go in there and get the fish out very quickly. So rig-wise for margin fishing, start with, I've got 020 Power Micron line as my main line. Very strong, durable. When fishing down to rushes, reed beds, you need something that's durable in case it rubs along the snag, it's gonna stay strong. Float, I've got a Matrix 0.3 Series 1 float, nice thick bristle. Any liners that you're going to get down there, it's not going to go under because it's going to be held buoyant above with the thick bristle. Down to a simple shotting pattern of 5 number 8s, which is just above a 6-inch hook length, which is again Power Micron, but this time in 018, slightly weaker than the main line. So in case of a breakage, it's just going to take my hook length and not the entire rig. And the hook is a size 12 carp bander hook. And I'm going to be fishing 3 pieces of corn on that. And putting the hook bait onto the hook couldn't be any easier. I like to use 3 pieces of corn. It keeps it nice and heavy again, pinned to the bottom. Put your first one on, thread it up. Another one on. And finally a third piece. And there you go. 3 pieces of corn, and that's going to stay nailed to the deck again, eliminating it blowing up and getting line bites. Coming to the final hour, I've just put a full pot of bait down in my margin. So it's time to go on it now, give it a go and see if there's anything turned up on it. Put my 3 pieces of corn on. I'll give this line roughly about 3 or 4 minutes, and if it hasn't gone under straight away, there's a good chance that the fish haven't turned up yet. Last thing you want to be doing is wasting your time on your margin line when there's still fish to be caught out on your longer lines. So we'll give it a go, 3 or 4 minutes, and if it doesn't go under, then we'll be back out catching fish on those other lines. There you go. That didn't take long. First put in, an hour to go, I've hooked one of the margin fish. I've hooked my elastic now. What I was using at 13 metres was the 8 hollow, and I've stepped up to a 10 hollow now. Just gives me that little bit more power and to get the fish in quicker, like we said before. It's all about getting the fish in quick so we can get in and get another one. Because we haven't got, it's last hour, we've got to put some fish in the net now. Also, I'm using this with a puller bung. Just allows me to get that fish in a little bit quicker using the lighter elastic. There you are. Nice 8-pounder, first chuck in, hour to go. Plenty more where that came from. Right, I've just caught that 8-pounder, first chuck in down the edge. I'm gonna refeed straight away. It's a little bit different to before where I was feeding every 20 minutes. Now, because the fish have turned up in my peg, I need to keep them there. So after every fish now, I'll be putting a full pot in. Same again, pellets and sweet corn. Last hour that's been. Everything's worked to plan. I've probably more than doubled my weight in the last hour. Quality carp like this. After every fish, like I said, in that last hour, I've fed a big pot and it's kept the fish in my swim and have been feeding that aggressively that I've sometimes only had to wait 4 or 5 seconds from putting my bait in to catching a carp. And this is probably one of the smaller ones, being about 6 or 7 pound. You'll follow what I've done today, and I promise you, you'll catch plenty of margin carp just like these.
Well, there's Geldart doing what he does best, which is absolutely hauling and emptying lakes all over the place. Now, Les, I noticed there that he had got an unconventional pole support.
Yeah, he was actually using what I've got here, to be fair. It's called a panoramic pole support.
What's the advantage there with that?
Basically, a normal pole support bar limits you to just that sort of range of between 11 o'clock and 1 o'clock. So you've only got a limited cover on your peg, and everyone has got a natural side which they would fish. They'd be left-handed, they'd be strung the one way, right-handed, I'm right-handed, so I'm always strung in this area of my peg. That's why I've got this set that way, because this is the side that I'll be weakest on. So if I wanted to fish at distance, say at 11 o'clock, I could quite comfortably hold it with my right arm. So this sort of area is fine with me. But if I wanted to fish at distance with a pole going past...
On your weak side.
Exactly. Yeah, when I start moving around that way, it all becomes unnatural because the butt of the pole is now starting to move closer to the body and I'm round here. So I can now switch over slightly, tag it to a weaker arm or go in between my legs if I wanted, and then it gives me more stability when I'm fishing that area of the swim or where I've put other lines where I think I can target fish thanks to this bar. That's why it's called the panoramic. It gives you a full range.
It's amazing, actually, if I can just come in there, that something so simple can give you so much of an advantage, because people might look at it and think, you know what, it's only another bar that you stick on your box, but actually it's opening up almost 50% more of your swim.
Spot on. I mean, it gives you so much more scope and comfort. And one thing I always say, if there's things out there that can make fishing easier, embrace them, because why struggle? In windy conditions, I've used one of these fishing 16 metres down a margin like Andy was doing. Now, if 16 metres that way for me is unnatural, that way is fine, you know, because everything's natural. I'm leaning with my body, but this way, it's not quite the same. But I've got all this.
Yeah. Without this, you might not even go there because you couldn't do it properly.
It's a lot harder days. It's more of a hard day's work. Yeah. You're looking at that line and you think, oh, do I really need to be going down there? I'll try and come a little bit shorter. But sometimes there's a feature there. I mean, Andy spoke about looking for cover. He got a pallet or staging. He got a little bit of a reed cover that gave the fish that little bit of extra confidence and security. That might have been at distance, a little bit further away from him. Yeah. And that's why he got that there. If he wanted to move down that other side, it was set in that position. He could have gone down and caught the fish quite comfortably without struggling and wrestling away with his pole.
Fantastic. Perfect feature. Awkward place. This is the answer. Now, something else I noticed he'd got there as well. He'd got two rollers at the back rather than one.
Well, that's again another massive advantage. I mean, when you're trying to catch fish at speed, two rollers is of paramount importance, because the less sections you have to keep taking apart, the quicker you get to the top kit. I've always said to lots of anglers who do say, oh, I've broke a pole, I've done this. Well, the top kit's the strongest part of the pole. The quicker you can get to that top kit, the quicker you're in control of the fish, so you're going to be netting it much faster. You saw Andy shipping straight through there. He was going across two quad rollers, and the banks were quite uneven, if you noticed. Mm. They were sloping. One was a lot lower than the other. With that quad system, it comes up on four legs with the cam locks and all the adjustment on him. He's found a level platform by doing all the adjustments, lined it through. He shipped back in one, onto the top kit, bang, speed.
Speed, time, smoothness, and the effort it takes to do it. If you can be smooth and everything, clearly it's going to make a difference.
Yeah, I mean, the elastics he was using as well, he spoke that he'd stepped up on his elastics. He'd come away from an 8, which is quite soft. He's gone a grade higher, but still, he was hooking fish, and it was still, there was enough strength in the elastic, but it was still soft enough so that when he hooked a fish, that they clear the swim. He didn't get too much commotion, they didn't crash. He had a couple that top straight away, but not many. What we saw, he lifted into the fish, the elastic comes up, it sets the hook, but then they just glide away slowly. You go too heavy sometimes with your elastic, you get the effect of, oh, I'm being pulled, I'm going to pull back. If I went to you and attached something to you and give a pull, you'd naturally want to go away.
Yeah.
He's just gone soft into the fish, that's what he's done.
And then he's just
come round, and that's when the two rollers have kicked in. Mm. He's come all the way around, he's connected with the first roller, he knows he's there, it's all in line, he's shipped straight through, onto the top kit, fish is in the net. And like he said, margin fishing is where you can turn round that last hour like that. You could go from potentially a third place to a first place. I mean, he said, what did he have on, 8 pounds?
He's doubled his weight in that last session. I want to talk to you about the last hour as well, because there's so many matches that are won in that last hour. Everyone calls it the golden hour. You know, this is the time when that match is going to be won. Does it have to be an hour? Would you come any earlier, or what's the plan? You could go down there straight away, but it's always the last hour.
This is a grey area with lots of anglers. I mean, watercraft is the key for this. You sit on your peg, you could be an end peg. Mm. For me, if I'm an end peg, that's a big factor on the time that I would feed that margin. I mean, Andy touched on, he likes to pay attention to what's happening around him, but who else is catching fish, and all the best match anglers always pay attention to what's happening in and around them, because you know you're trying to keep a gauge on where you sit in the position of the match. You want to look, well, he's catching fish, you know, am I on the pace with him? Oh, that's two, is that I need to change. That's, you know, that happens when you learn your match craft, you piece your matches together. When he said that he likes to feed it 2 hours before the end, I'm of the opinion that that is spot on. If you're on a standard peg, I mean, bear in mind, he was there, he's on that lake. If you're in a match situation, there's going to be lots of pressure on that lake. There's anglers all around him. If you start feeding it too soon, you'll accumulate a bigger pile of bait. Mm. So when they do finally switch on, and lots of things factor into this, Carp, especially on commercial waters, get quite conditioned. They get used to nets entering the water. When nets come out, leftover bait being thrown into the lake at the end of a match, they know exactly what's going on. Mm. They come in, they start to cruise into the margins, looking for the free offerings after a match. He's gone down that edge with 2 hours to go. If he'd have done that from the start, by the time that 2 hours comes, there'd be literally be a mountain of bait. Too many fish would come. He'd probably foul hook fish. They'd be overconfident. It would just become carnage. What he's actually done there, he's targeted an area. He's gone in. He's taken a fish. Then he's fed again. He's taken a fish. So he's actually taking a fish to a feed, a fish to a feed. If there was a massive pile there, it would have been one fish, foul hook, disturbance. It just becomes carnage. It's just not good.
The heavy bait was a great tactic as well, wasn't it? Getting it down on the deck to avoid that foul hooking and the movement of that bait around on the deck.
You look at the size of the fish he was catching, you imagine that tail. I mean, when a fish gets netted, everything collapses. But when it's in the water and it's working, I mean, in a foot and a half at one, I think it was just like 2 foot of water there.
Yeah, yeah.
That big tail pattern, that's a lot of movement. So he's decked it down, 3 pieces of corn, a bigger hook, and he got 4 blocks of, well, I think it was 4 number 8s in a block, straight down. So literally that tail's moving around. He might not be the only carp that's there. There could be 2 of those. He's kept his bait solid.
And he's making the most of the time that he's got in that last hour. Well, absolutely fantastic. Now, one of my favourite parts of that whole film was when he was mugging him off the top. Now, Les went out. He's been having a few as well, haven't you, Les, out there when you went out with
the cameras? Yeah, we went to the Glebe, which is, you know, a fantastic venue. I mean, Roy Marlowe's place is just, it literally is the mecca of commercial fisheries to some people. And, you know, there's not so many matches on there for the open circuit. When you can get on there, it's a privilege to fish in, and we had a really good day.
There was a bit of mugging going on, so why don't we have a look exactly how Les got on.
We're here today at the fantastic Glebe complex. I'm on pool 2, the sun's back in the sky, temperatures are on the rise and the carp are moving. I'm going to run you through today a lot of the tactics I use to catch lots of fish shallow. The reason why I fish shallow, well, once I've been fishing on the bottom, if I start getting too many indications, too many liners, bits of movement, odds tail and swirl patterns around the float, when bait's being fed into the peg, that gives me that little alarm call to say, right, it's time to come right up into the top layers of the water, just that top third where all those fish will be hanging about, congregating, picking all the bits of bait up that are falling through. There's also the odd occasion where you turn up and the carp would already be surface feeding, be it insects, little bits of fluff, odd particles that are still remaining from past sessions, just floating around on the surface. They're just all congregated there, just waiting for you when you turn up. But as a general rule of thumb, you would generally work from the bottom right the way through to the top of the surface. My shallow setups are dead simple. That's what, like with all my fishing, I like to keep it dead simple. First, let's have a look at the elastic. It's just a TENS matrix hollow. The reason I use a TENS, I want it to be nice and soft. When I hook a fish, I want to connect with it and just let that fish just gently just cruise away, leave the feeding area, don't want to spook any of the other fish. I've got an 016 mainline, power micron, right the way down to a 75mm 014 power micron hook length. A little tiny 20s bander with a little band tied on the back in a knotless knot fashion. I've got a bulk of 3/8 and the float of choice is a matrix dobber, 0.2 of a gram, cracking little floats these, really strong. They've got an inline body and an eye at the top for extra strength, fantastic for whipping over. And the whipping over is a key thing because it's creating a false feed. So that's where that little connector on the end comes into play. If I'm using a normal plastic PTFE connector, I can get wrap overs and all the rest of it.
but with a little bit of flexibility in that Dacron connector, it allows me to keep whipping and whipping and whipping, reduces tangles to a bare minimum, hardly get any to be honest. This rig in particular is the rig that I use when the fish are at the most aggressive. I've got quite a long line to the top of the float because I don't really want the pole over the top of the rail. I don't want them spooking off. But that bulk in that position there and the shorter depth will mean that when the pellets are hitting the surface, the fish are really aggressive, they're swirling. I'm trying to target that fish literally. The bait will go in, my rig will whip over, it will drop through at the same time, crack, straight on with the fish. The bulk also is in that position because when a pellet is attached to that band, as I whip over, I'll get three contacts on the water, all in a line. Dink, 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 like as if three pellets have gone onto the surface. So I've created a false feed. I do that three times in quick succession. I've fed nine pellets to the mind's eye of the fish, but nothing's actually gone in except my single pellet just falling through. So they charge through. They're thinking that I've continued to feed between six and nine pellets, ping, ping, ping. But actually, because I've gone quick three times over, there's one there, they're charging, they're competing, bang, elastics out, let it clear the peg, feed, and start the process again. The other rig that I use, same float. Like I say, I like to keep all my fishing dead simple, same elastic, same connector again, because I don't want tangles. But this time, it's in all out in a strung out fashion. It's nice and balanced, it falls through the water nice and slowly. So I get an equal four with all the rest of the pellets that are being loose fed. Nice and simple. That's what shallow fishing is. It's akin to margin fishing. It's an aggressive method. When fish are competing and they're really charging through your peg, you can really knock up a weight really quickly. The final rig that I always, well, for the last 5 or 6 years, it's really come to the fore, is the dobbing rig. Dobbing, that's the name that's been given to a method that's been used by lots of anglers to great success up and down the country over the last few years when they arrive at a peg and it's literally loaded with fish. Just skulking around on the surface, you just drop a rig in front of it, of one that you pick out, and then bang, the fish takes it. Lots and lots of big match qualifiers have been won doing this. But what's the best way to do it? I find that using a tiny little series 2 float in 0.2, a 75mm hook length once again, a carp bandus hook whipped on with a knotless knot and a boilie spike. The reason I like a boilie spike is because I like a nice visual bait, and that's what dobbing's all about. You want a bait that's visual, you drop it in front of an unsuspecting fish, he sees it, he likes it, he takes it straight away. There's a few dobbing fish in front of me now. The next key part to it is keeping the pole away from them. Be mindful of where the sun is in the sky, the shadow that's being cast on the water from the pole, because if you bring the pole round in the wrong direction, the shadow will hit the fish first, spook the fish, so you defeated the object. You're trying to creep up on these fish. If you're creeping up, again, you need a longer line to your float. I've probably got between 4 and 5 foot of line there, right the way down, and at the moment I'm fishing probably 6 inches deep, so there's a few fish about. I'm just gonna have a look now, see if I can just dob a couple. Put an extra section on, because there's a few more a little bit just further out of range. Another key feature, and an absolute must really, is the old sunglasses. Polaroid sunglasses take the glare off the water. It lets me see all the shadows of the fish that are moving around. Anything that comes into my eye line in any direction, I pick up on it straight away. Without these, I get all the surface glare, miss out on lots of fish. So they are a major tool and a great asset to when you're dobbing for fish. That's just dropped right in front of one now. Bang, there's one. There are actually three fish there just swimming through, and I've just dropped that little white boilie in front of them. And that's the key, you see, that visual bait. I mean, you don't have to use a boilie, but I just prefer to because I can always leave it in amongst when I've got all my rigs. And if I ever see a dobbing fish coming past, I can just quickly pick it up because the boilie spike is fully loaded on straight away. with that boilie, I can go out and ping straight in front of an unsuspecting fish and they nail it straight away. It's the visual aspect, you're irritating the fish, you're putting it right in his eye line. It could be bread, it could be corn, but for me, it's boilies. As you can see now, I'm using a puller kit, soft elastics. Puller kits are a must, an absolute must. And I've said it many times before that they're a real game changer on the commercial scene. They allow us to fish much lighter. Elastics that let the fish just clear the peg. Also with this method, because you're using such a longer line for fishing shallow, you need to be bringing more elastic back into the pole to bring the fish into netting range. So again, puller kit comes into its own. This actually feels like a much better fish, and you normally find that with dobbing fish. It's always the old battle cruisers that have seen it all before that are just mulling around on the surface. And it's a really effective way of building a weight really quickly. I remember a couple of years back at Viaduct Fishery, there's a friend of mine had near something like 300 pound of fish doing this, got himself into another major final. It certainly is a devastating method on any given day. I'm looking out on the lake now as I'm playing this, there's lots more fish moving in. So literally I'll be landing this fish, shipping straight back out, the summit 6 metres. And that's the beauty of doing this dobbing method. I could literally land this fish, drop back out again straight away and pick another one up at 6 metres, and I'm bumping a weight up really quick. Got some fighting in this one, to be fair. Here he is, yeah. Angry old goat. It looks like a ghosty. Yeah, it is, yeah. Little ghosty, lovely fish. He couldn't resist that white boilie, that's for sure. Beautiful fish. There we go. Another one that's fallen to dobbing. And there's lots more out there still. Let's just unhook this one and get back in. When your fish push beyond the pole range, the tactic to use is the pellet waggler. Another devastating method when you're fishing shallow. Rod that I use is 11 foot carp master float, rated from 3 to 8 pound with line. The main line I'm using is a 6 pound with a 5 pound bottom, short hook length yet again. It's a loaded float and it's stopped off with 2 float gripper stops. They just let me run the float up and down the line without creating any line damage whatsoever. I'm going to be using bigger pellets now. I'm going to be using 8 mils because I need to go that little bit further with distance, so I want to keep my accuracy, and I'm going to be casting into that area, hopefully picking up a few fish. The reel that I'm using is a 4000 size Aquos, balances perfectly with a rod, line lays ever so good on these reels, gives you a nice even accurate cast. The hook, I've gone for a different pattern this time, slightly wider bend, a little bit heavier gauge in the rigger, size 14, because I'm going to be fishing an 8 mm pellet. Let's cast this one in, see if we can pick up a fish just that's moved off that pole line. It's simply a case of putting an 8 mm on. So we'll grab the banding tool, put the band on. Cracking little tools these. Gone are the days when we used to have a band left on holding all the needles together. No bands needed anymore. You just get your 8 mm, pick out a nice one. I'll try and find one that's slightly longer. Just slide it in and just transfer that band to the pellet. Dead simple, dead quick. No more fiddling about and twisting and turning, trying to get a band on. It all goes on nice and neat. There's already a few fish milling about that have backed off from that pole line. Yeah, cast the pellet waggler in, and I fancy us to have a few on this method. Simply get yourself four, five pellets. You always feed before you're going to cast. I'll give them a couple of pouches because we haven't fed them for a while. There's little signs of fish there. Just ping over. Ducks are interested anyway. And then you cast. gets one straight away. Such aggressive takes. There were lots of fish competing with him about. He's heading for them snags, to be honest. Just get a turn on him. Yeah, that's got him. But as soon as those pellets were touching the water, there was fish turning, moving, going over the top of the feed. The waggler crashes down, there's a splash, which is like a false feed. More pellets travelling through with the other pellets, well, they're the free offerings. One comes in, bang, they drag the rod. Very often you need to strike. It pays to strike, watch the float, but lots of the times the rod just gets dragged straight round. Didn't even get a chance to just feed. Normally I feed a few if I don't get a bite, just a little bit shorter of the float just to give myself a second bite of the cherry really, so that I can drag the float back into another area of feed just a little bit shorter, so I get two chances. But I never leave that waggler in very long anyway. You're talking 30 seconds to a minute, any more than that really, and then you want to be casting because you want to get a repetition of the waggler hitting the water, your pellets, all becomes, it all builds up, you get yourself a nice rhythm, which is the same as any sort of shallow fishing really. Once you get into a rhythm, it all becomes so natural. And you're constantly casting, feeding, casting, feeding, casting, landing fish. When you're playing a fish, you want to feed. Just build the swim up, keep everyone all confident, so that when you're casting again, there's another one waiting. In addition to pellet waggler fishing, also the bagging waggler can be a devastating method when you're shallow fishing with a rod and line. I'll get this one in the net and I'll talk you through it. When most anglers hear the word bagging waggler, they think about a piece of balsa, sometimes 10, 12 inches long, and a great big metal cage underneath that you'd be throwing right into the middle of a lake. Matrix have taken that a little bit further, and the team have decided that they can refine that method and use it in everyday commercial fishing. And what we've done is on an interchangeable system, so you'd simply now I'd wind off my pellet waggler, like so. Remove the weights, the little shims. And that's the first part of the micro bagging waggler. What you do then, you take this little cage, which is the feeder part, attach that to the bottom of the float, then put it all back onto the thread, and just nice and easy, just wind it all back together. That's now ready to be loaded with pellets, ground bait, nice free offerings to cast out back to those areas that the pole can't reach. It's a devastating method, it really is. It's a rod dragger. They come in, all the particles are falling. Your pellet or your boilie or whatever you're using as a hook bait is falling in amongst them. They're in there competing. They also, because of the ball on the top, you get a nice splash. You don't get any plunge. Everything's all in one neat ball, all breaking down together, and those fish homing and targeting. Perfect for when you can't get pellets with a catapult or any bait for that matter to that area where you want to be fishing. That's now ready for loading. Dead simple. The cage that's on the float's got four sides. All I like to do is regulate my feed, and that's the beauty of these. They bring a little bit of finesse to it. You can, if you want, you'll accept lots and lots of bait. You can really pack it around there. What I like about it is I can fill 1, 2, 3, 4 segments. And cut back feed, put a little bit, if I think, well, they're having a little bit too much, they're getting a little bit too frenzied, I can just fill the 1 or 2 panels. What I'll do now, I'll just quickly show you how I like to load it. Just get some pellets, there's some pellets here and a little bit of ground bait just mixed in just to create that little bit of a cloud as it hits the water, and then slowly all the pellets start to drift off and break down like they would off a method feeder at the bottom of the lake. It's just happening at the top. You've turned the peg on its head really. Just get the feeder, get the bottom end of the float, the feeder part, and just press and just pack in. Nice and simple. Same again. It's just like loading a method feeder, but on a float. Nice and simple. Press, just fill up the compartments. Last one. Just nice, dead, easy and simple. And that's what I'm saying. There's quite a lot of feed on there. There's enough cloud, all that will start to break down. If I wanted to, I could pack it right out. They do accept a lot of bait, but that's just enough for what I need. Let's cast this in and see if we can pick another one up. So we're just going to cast that in. Down she goes. See how that ball didn't let it plunge or nothing, like it just stayed on top of the surface. Now, underneath that pellet, that's just falling. We've got all particles breaking off. They're all falling over the top of what's my hook bait. It's all breaking down. There's that little bit of cloud. There's one just swirled the back of it then. There we go. Like I said, this really is a fantastic method. But for me, when it really comes into its own, is when you're fishing in a situation where you're throwing towards an island. If you've been fishing a method feeder, and there's lots of bites, they've got really gone really iffy, you've picked up lots of fish and they've wised up to what the feeder's doing, you can literally turn your peg upside down and just fish it the same way but from above. So instead of that method feeder breaking down on the bottom and all those particles, and then they come in and they nose around your bait, now everything's just lifted up and there's particles everywhere throughout that column of water. You can fill this little micro bagging waggler up just like you would a method feeder, with some pellets, some ground bait. Regulate your feed, like I said, depending on how many sides of the feeder you want to fill up. You'll cast it over, you'll hit the surface, you'll get the plop as if a feeder's gone in. All those pellets will break down. It won't plunge, as we've seen, because the ball on the top stops it from crashing all the way through. And as it starts to break down, you're then fishing it from the up from, like I said, your peg is now switched. It's from the top down. And all those fish that are mulling around and picking all the bits that are wafting up and fanning from the bottom, there they are, your hook bait's in amongst it, particles dropping all around it, and bang, another fish is taken. It just keeps fish ticking over, and it's just another approach to keep fish coming when you think to yourself, well, I've got an island peg, do I throw a feeder, do I throw a waggler? It's a mixture of the two and can be totally devastating. Fantastic day sport we've had today at the Glebe. We've kept shallow fish coming all day just by keep swapping and changing from the various methods that I've showed you, be it normal shallow fishing, dobbing or pellet waggler. It just shows if you keep chopping and changing and following that fish that keep backing off throughout your peg, you can keep fish coming and get bags like these. I hope these tips have been useful to you and they help you to put more fish in your net throughout the coming season.
Well, it looks like he had an awful lot of fun out there as well, and that was absolutely solid, that peg, wasn't it?
Oh, well, like most of the pegs at the Glebe, you know, you've got a chance to win off lots of pegs there, and you get yourself on an end like that. That's what people like to get towards, and they just ram the fish. The place is absolutely solid. And
proper exciting fishing when they're up on the surface as well. You're seeing them.
There's nothing more exciting, as they say. They come in, you see a take, you get a swirl, you get the crash and the splash, and there's nothing better than surface fishing and shallow fishing. I absolutely love it, to be fair.
Well, you've got your rig in front of you now. Let's have a quick look at that. Just talk us through it.
Yeah, the dobbing rig. Well, I mean, it's one of those methods that some anglers, like I say, they frown upon it. They don't like the technique of, I can see a fish, I'm going to drop it in front of it, because they see it as a bit of an easy prey. But I'm of the thinking that...
It's got to be catching when you can.
Exactly. If you're in a situation to win a match or qualify for a big final, whatever method that you need to do to get there, as long as it's legal and you're not breaking any rules, you should embrace it. You know, you should embrace it. And I've got to be honest, I've been guilty in the past of some methods that I don't like doing. Mm. I've left them alone. I've thought back after, I thought, you mug, you should have gone on that. You know, don't think just because you don't like doing it that you shouldn't. You know, and there is a skill to it. There is an art form to it. Like I said, that with the pole, being mindful of where the shadow is when it casts a shadow on the water. I mean, you drop that shadow on top of the fish before the pole gets there, you're going to spook the fish. And there's lots of things to take into account. And the rig itself, I mean, I use, opposed to the dobber, which has a longer stem, which I cut down slightly. These have got a much shorter carbon stem. They're all balsa. That's a size, a 0.2 of a gram. The three shot this time, as opposed to normal shallow fishing where I'd string it or I'd put it there to create those false feeds, I want the bait when I'm actually trying to catch a cruiser just to fall really, really slow. You know, you want to catch its attention. You're throwing towards its eye line. You're not literally just dropping it in front of his mouth. There's what people think, you know, they say, oh, there's a cruiser. I'm going to stick it in front of him and he's going to eat it. There's plenty of times you'll do it and they'll just carry on,
around it,
mosey on.
Little bypass round.
You know this.
You've got to use a slow sinking bait though for that, really, to get the best of it.
Yeah, well, that's why I choose a boilie and a boilie spike. And these are like a semi-buoyant boilie. They sink really, really slow. And it makes it so easy just to just get the spike and just load it up. You're just pushing it in. You're done in seconds, you know, that's it. We're on it, spike's done, and you're already loaded. Now that's gonna go in, you're gonna launch it out. I mean, that's why, like I stated, the importance of having more line to the float, because you don't wanna be dropping the pole tipping right. I mean, if I brought the pole right around in front of that fish, he's seeing a pole before he sees the bait. So I'm just gonna be launching it and just swinging it in front of him. And then when it falls, because that's semi-buoyant, it's just gonna go nice and steady, nice and slow, bang. And that's what we saw. We dropped it in amongst them and they nailed it.
So have a little look at that spike again. Just pop that spike on there, pull it off. So there's the spike. Now, are you confident that your bait's going to stay on there? Because when you're casting out, if you're stopping it on the way in, is the bait not going to come off?
Absolutely. I mean, it's twisted as well, so it cuts its own key. Mm. I mean, because you know the substance of a boilie is quite firm. And like I say, they're semi-buoyant. Once they're pressed in, they're attached. And you can just keep swinging it around. Sometimes they'll pop off when you've actually caught the fish and you need to reload, but I always like to keep it loaded on the side with all the rigs. If I see one, and that was like I said about the importance of the glasses, the polarized glasses, really important. You just catch one in the eye line and they pop up at different sessions. I mean, there's lots of pegs, and I spoke about a friend of mine. You get to a peg and you've got in excess of 200 pound of carp on a surface, you're gonna tell me you're gonna ignore them. Mm.
Gotta be done.
I think the biggest hang up about the method is, it's not so much it's the dislike of the method, it's just feeling aggrieved that you've not drawn that peg that's absolutely loaded with the fish and you can do nothing about it, because once those fish start taking on the surface, you're powerless to affect anything. It's not like any other sort of fishing. You can, if they're catching down, they're catching on the method, you fishing the same sort of things can affect, essentially, slow them down, slow people down around you. You start taking fish and get competing, you can up your feed with dobbing. They're fish that are sulking around on the surface, basking, eating natural baits and things that are there. So,
great way of picking those ones that are doing that. But drawing fish into your peg, and you've just said about pinching your fish off the peg next door. Let's face it, what you've got to do is you've got to catch more than the bloke next door. And if you can take his fish off him, brilliant. Absolutely. Concentrating the feed, very, very important. And the old waggler. You've got a set of them down here, that's perfect for that.
Yeah, I mean, when they go out of pole range, like I said, you need to switch to a waggler, and the pellet waggler is a really, really popular a tactic on lots of venues up and down the country. And as you saw, we did a twist, you know, we created another system, very similar to like what we did with the feeder fishing. Again, time is of the essence. I'd need three rods set up for different things, such as the impact waggler, the pellet waggler, the micro bagging waggler. I mean, I actually said it wrong on the video. I did actually call that, a micro bagging waggler. That's the micro bagging waggler. That is the impact waggler.
Let's have a look at this. Let's look at the pellet waggler first. So the pellet waggler is exactly what it says on the tin. It's a pellet waggler. Weighted at the bottom, decent float, nice bit of tip so you can see it at distance, and you can punch that a long way, can't you?
Yeah, like I said, the key to the pellet waggler fishing is repetition. You're casting, you're in the water like 30 seconds to a minute, you back out, you're feeding, you cast, you feed, you cast. I like to feed, like I said, a metre in front and drag it in so I get two bites of cherry, and you're building it up. I mean, it's not a static method, unlike traditional waggler fishing. You'd throw it out and you'd feed and you'd wait for a bite. You want that constant noise, you're ringing a dinner bell as such, and that's really what shallow fishing is, that constant repetition of pellets. You get the splash off the waggler that creates that false feed like I was doing with the pole, so they feel like, oh, what, you've got the noise.
And sound's such a massive thing for feeding fish, isn't
especially
it?
With carp. Carp love noise. They're very intuitive. They come charging in, having a good look around, and that was the essence of that.
So you've got the pellet waggler, but there's occasions where you need to have the bagging waggler. You want more feed around, and there's two options on that, isn't it? You can actually just get the cages separately and they will go directly on.
Yeah, I mean, so you can adapt it. It's quite simple. If I just take that waggler, you can just unscrew the bottom of the float. I mean, that will be
attached. This one there, one we've made earlier.
You just unscrew it. If you wanted to, it depends on how much bait you wanted to put on, so you'd probably remove some of the shims or take them all off.
And that's the same cage, basically, that you get in the packet with the two in
it. Yeah, it's the
same.
You can buy them as a standalone, just as a waggler, or you could buy them with the cage where it comes in complete, just as one set. You just attach and then turn it over. So again, it's another system, you know, and the advantages of using just one rod when you've got to set things up to just quickly switch and change. Yeah. It's easy to ring the changes when you're fishing with a pole, not so easy when you're fishing with a rod and line. And these systems, such as the Evolution Feeder and these wagglers, they're giving you some serious edges to catch fish.
Well, you know, we've spoken about speed a number of times, and the shims here are a massive edge as well, because you can change the weight of this float very quickly, can't you? With the addition of the two different shims.
There you go. You just drop those on there.
Pop it on, and another one again.
Just straight on. You load it up. I mean, you'll remove and you'll add, depending what baits you're fishing throughout the day. I mean, you could switch from size of pellets to 11 mil. They'll all make a difference. From 11s down to 8s or 6s, they'll make a difference on the tip. So you remove a shim or you put one back on.
And the whole system's interchangeable. But I must say, of all of them, I've got a particular favourite. And I just think that is such a great invention.
I really do think these are going to be really popular on the match circuit, to be honest. And some of the fish that I've caught using these when we've been testing them, it's frightening.
It's the impact, this one, isn't it? I mean, it's called impact because
exactly,
it's almost
the impact. It hits the water, it doesn't plunge. And if you'd have said to me, you know, right up until I saw these, you know, we're going to fish bagging waggler. I mean, this is an impact waggler. Mm. We've bought that bagging waggler right into the mainstream. I mean, we've took it from a great big ugly piece of balsa and a big horrible cage on the bottom, refined it, and the team have done a great job just bringing it. I mean,
Everybody should have one of these.
How neat is that? I mean, did you see when I actually cast it out? I mean, those carp were there. Yeah. It hit the surface. It just stayed there.
It didn't plunge. There's no diving.
I mean, they actually just carried on. In fact, you actually saw tail patterns where they started to just move down from the surface and start to pick up the particles that were breaking up. We saw tail patterns, you know.
But every now and again, a product comes out and you think that's a winner straight away.
The game changes on it.
You look at this, and in the match fishing world, yes. You know what, actually, it works in the carp fishing world, it works in the pleasure fishing world. It's just a brilliant, brilliant angling product.
Yeah, and like I touched on that, I just love the fact the different ways you can load it. I mean, a normal bagging waggler, you know, they're crude and cumbersome. I mean, I can use that fishing towards an island, but I wouldn't feel comfortable throwing a great, big, horrible bagging waggler there, because it's going to hit, it's going to plunge, it's going to hit the bottom, and then eventually pop itself back up. I mean, these can be fished, especially with the style where the feeder is actually on in the micro bagging waggler. That could be fished on a slow sinking if you wanted to. There's so many variations that you could do with it. But with this one, I love the fact that I could load different sections, so I can always be conscious and mindful just how much feed I'm exactly putting through that peg.
Absolutely. Well, there we go. That, without any shadow of doubt, is an edge. And talking of edges, what we're going to do now is we're going to head over to Ferry Meadows, that mecca of long-range bream fishing, where Grant Albutt is going to be fishing on the feeder.
Bye. joining me today at Ferry Meadows. Here we are in two nice big bream. And what we'll do, we'll talk you through it when we get him in the net. Talk you through the tactics, how we set up, how we feed, and how we catch fish like this.
Get in there. Come on.
The rod I'm using today is a 3.8 S-Class Horizon, and it's absolutely perfect for medium to long chucks, 60, 70, 80 yards sort of thing. I've got a number 3 tip in it, which, because I'm using a 60 gram feeder, you know, I want it to be nice and balanced. So when I'm chucking, I know I've got the confidence that I'm not going to break the tip because my feeder is too heavy for it. You want to use a 5,000 to 6,000 reel, which balances with the rod. You use a too small a reel, when you're casting, it just won't feel right. And obviously, because you're chucking such, you know, good distances, you want a nice size spool for the line to come off nicely. Talking of the line itself, I'm using 010 braid with a 12-pound carp master shocker, obviously for that initial cast. So because you're using 60, 70 gram feeders, you don't want to crack off, which you can do on the cast. Okay, we've got the bream coming in now. Just get his head up in the water and then just put your lanyard underneath it. Keep him coming in the water, lift him out. There we go. Lovely Ferry Meadows bream. Okay, before I chuck back out, I want to talk to you about this 60 gram Horizon feeder what we're using today. And the reason I'm using one of these is because I want to get good distance, and because the weight's at the bottom, when I cast it, this is going to carry it through the wind. No matter how windy it is, I'm going to get to where I need to get to with this because of the weight of it. And obviously when you add ground bait to it, it's going to make it a bit more heavier, so I'm going to get to where I want to get every single time. Well, once the feeder's loaded, it's going to be 65 to 70 grams. So what I use is a Carp Master 12-pound shock leader, which is tied direct to my braided line. And the reason I use this is because it absorbs all the force of when I'm casting out to 70 yards. So rather than having a crack off, that's why I use a 12-pound shock. As you can see, the feeder's loaded now. It weighs between 65 and 70 grams. It's a free running on our shocker. And this is a Horizon protector sleeve. And why have we got one of them? Because the constant casting that we do possibly weaken the line because we're chucking at 70 yards, and that will prevent the swivel from damaging the line. Okay, beneath the sleeve, what we've got just a swivel there, which we can obviously push that back over, and then all we do is we add our hook length to it. It's just a simple loop, pull your hook through, and it attaches there nicely. I've got 2 foot of 016 power micron just attached to the swivel at the bottom there. I'm fishing over a little bit of weed today, so that's why I'm fishing over 2. Bites have been really positive, but there's every chance that you might not be connecting with your bites, so maybe you want to shorten it down to a foot or maybe less than that. It just depends on the day really, but I'm fishing with one of these today and it's working really well for me. Okay, we're going to go to the business end now, and I'm using an SW barbed feeder hook, which is a size 12, and the reason I'm using a size 12 is because I'm fishing with a piece of corn, and they are quite big fish, and the thing is, when you get them under your feet and they're shaking their heads, with a smaller hook there's every chance you could pull out of them, so that's why I'm using the bigger hook, so I'll get a better hold on them. We'll be right back. Well, I've done my homework on the place and sweet corn's been working really well here. However, you always need to have a change of bait if that bait isn't working on the day. Maggots, casters, worms, dead red maggots, you know, for instance, is a fantastic bait. But obviously at the same time, you're gonna have to scale down. You might want to be using an 012 or an 014 rather than when I'm using an 016 and a 12 hook. So always balance your hook length and hook to your baits that you're using. Right, I've used a bag of Pro Natural, which is 1.5 kilos, and I've also used half a bag of G Gold, which is 2 kilos in total. And I've used the data mix today because this lake that I'm fishing is quite clear. So I want to try and get it the same colour as the bottom of the lake. So that's why I've gone for this sort of colour. Right, the reason I mixed up 2 kilos of ground bait, I've done a bit of homework and I know the locals have been using roughly 2 kilos of ground bait. And what I want to do is I want to spend 15-20 minutes of putting quite a bit of better bait down for when the bream do arrive, you know, I want them to stay. I do this by having no hook length on, just the feeder itself, and continually casting for 20, you know, like I said, 20 minutes or so to not put a nice bed of bait down. And then what I've done, I've added my hook length, second chuck, I've had a bream, 7 pound. Okay, what I normally do before, obviously, as I'm filling my feeder, is I add, you know, a few grains of pellets into my mix and a few grains of corn into my ground bait as well. And I mix them round, and as I'm filling the feeder up, I'm putting my ground bait, bits of pellets in there, and a few grains of corn, obviously. I don't want to put too many grains of corn in because, obviously, I'm fishing with corn today, and I want my bit of corn that's on the hook to stand out. So don't go too mad on putting stuff in that you're using on the hook. Okay, I just want to show you how easy it is to load my feeder. It's a cage feeder, so I like to hold it around the sides and then just keep feeding it in with my thumb. And what you're doing, you're holding the side so it's not coming out. So just trimming off nicely before I throw it out. And there we go, fully loaded cage feeder, ready to chuck. As we're bream fishing, we need to be very accurate at this. So first of all, what we do, we use measuring sticks. They're 3 metres apart, and I've gone around them 23 times. That's exactly 69 metres. So I know I'm fishing 69 metres every time. And the reason I know that is because also, on my reel, I've got a clip. So when I stand up and cast out, it's gonna hit the clip, and I know I'm bang on the money every time. It's very, very important to keep your bait going in same area every cast because you want the shoal to come into that area all the time. You want this to drop through the middle of it so when it lands in the water, you bang on the money every time. It's very, very important. Before you start, you need to look on the far bank and pick a feature that isn't gonna move because obviously you wanna be chucking to it all the time. There's no good picking another angler, you want to be picking something that stands out, i.e. a tree or something like that. And make sure you cast to that every time. If you don't hit your clip properly, and you don't hit your mark out, it's left to the right, let your feeder sink first, don't just automatically reel it in, because what you're doing, you're dragging all the bait across the top then. Let it hit the bottom, and then reel it in, because at least you're leaving the bait on the bottom. Right, I've got my marker on the far bank, let's put this theory into practice. I have my feeder about a metre away from the top. You don't want it too close. You want a nice, so when it's all in action, one action, bring it back slowly, punch it out. Hold your rod up in the air to feather your feeder down. There we go, nice. And then drop your rod, sink your line, and waiting for the fish to pull your tip round. We'll be right back. And here we are, end of the session. Last chuck, another bream. Don't be afraid to put some bite in for these fish. These are big fish, they want plenty of bite. You know, even if you're casting regular and it doesn't happen, don't be afraid to take the hook length off and put 10, 15 feeder falls in. Don't be afraid to do that, because you want to get them there, and when you get them there, you want them to stay there. And then it'll produce fish like this, cracking bream. Don't forget, accuracy is the key. Don't forget that marker on the far bank. Make sure it keeps going in that place all the time. You go to the left or go to the right, let that feeder at the bottom and then reel it in. Don't drag your feeder across the top if you're inaccurate, because it'll drag feed everywhere. So let it go to the bottom first and then reel it in. You must be accurate. It's the key to fishing for bream. Oh, that's a nice one. Yes. That's one of the brings to the day, that. Oh, well, there we go. Last fish of the day, pushing 7 pound, I would say, at least. What a cracking day's fishing. First time I've ever been to Ferry Meadows. Absolutely brilliant day's fishing. And can't wait to come back.
Well, Ferry Meadows, what can you say? It's the bream mecca, but that's natural venues like that. They're indicative of quite a few venues all over the country, aren't they? Patsall, for one, I know you fish there.
Yeah, Patsall. I mean, there's a lot. There's Arrow Valley's another one near me. I mean, there's Winsford, Rudyard, Coombe Abbey. There's lots of big, vast natural spaces of water. And, you know, they pick up lots of weed, and I think you've got to take lots of things into consideration.
He mentioned weed there, actually, didn't he? Which is, it's an interesting thing, because the match anglers normally wouldn't want to fish over weed, but Ferry Meadows, you've got to.
No, well, you've got no choice, really. There's not really many clear areas there, but he did say he found the slightest area of reed he could find, and he managed to do that by using the braid that he was using with a heavy lead. He'd keep throwing it out, drop that lead down, and he'd find a nice little area where it weren't going to be too snaggy. He'd feel it all through the tip. Mm. He'd find that area, clip up, then get on his measuring sticks. He's got a nice area to work.
It's an absolute must, really, braid for that, isn't it? I know a lot of the lads in Ireland use braid as well. What are we talking about?
Well, the braid he was using was the 010 braid, the submerge sinking feeder braid. It is a cracking braid. It sinks like lead. I know lots of my friends who fish the Ireland Festival Circuit, they're all switched to this braid. It is very, very popular.
What's the benefit then? Why is it so good? It's obviously very fine and nice and supple.
It's fine, it's supple. I mean, distance is a key. He was throwing 69 metres with ease. That's, and that, the reason is that diameter, 0.1 over a millimetre. You're throwing it out, it flies through the rings of the rod. The shock absorber's the key. That carries all the load. So, bang, he fires it out. He got that protector sleeve as well. That's there to stop it actually rubbing. The constant casting, I mean, you could cast in excess of, you know, 200 times during a match. You're going to create a weak spot. That protects it. One thing they do as well, after so many casts, they will kick just slightly, and they throw the hook length away from the feeder a little bit more. They're a cracking piece of kit when you're throwing at distance, you know, and bites. When you're fishing at distance like that, the response from when a fish picks it up to the tip when you're using braid just gives you a much truer bite. The slightest of touches, a great indication, comes from all that distance back to that tip.
It was very clean looking at the tip going round there. You could see the bite, very, very clean.
Bite. I mean,
no mistake in it.
No, you know, he knew straight away the tip had gone, there's one. I mean, again, and the size of the fish, I mean, from 5 to 6, 7 pounds, I mean, it looked awesome.
Brilliant, isn't it? Now, distance-wise, to me as a carp angler, you know, we fish at very, very long range sometimes, but 69 metres, that's a long way. What, do you think there's much more that you can go?
Oh, there's a lot more. I mean, since the England feeder team, feeder fishing has become real more mainstream. There's lots more feeder matches now. Mm. Some anglers are actually just setting all their stall out in a year just to fish these feeder matches. And if you do really want to push it further, like I said earlier, you should always get the right tools for the job. Make it easier for yourself. I mean, if you're pushing your own rods to the limit, get a different rod. I mean, the rod that you'd have wanted then to go even further would have been a 4.3 horizon. and stick with that reel and let the rod do the work. Once you've loaded it up with the right weight feeder, let the rod do the work, not your arms. Don't struggle. The tools are there to get the job done much, much easier.
It's all about that kit, isn't it? Getting the distance. And the other thing is that if you can get that distance, it isn't just about being able to fish 80 or even 90, which is a massive distance. If you can actually reach 80 or 90, then when you're fishing at 60, it's going to be very comfortable and also very, very accurate too.
Yeah, I mean, you've always got to remember, the fish might not always be feeding at that distance. The only chance you might have for that slightly less weedier area might be in excess of 80, 90, 100 metres even. You can easily do that with those bigger rods and you wouldn't have to struggle. I mean, you would struggle with, I mean, I see anglers do it, they're standing up and the rod just hasn't got enough compression in the blank. When the blanks are loaded with the right size feeder, the rod actually does the work. It all transfers through.
The sweet spot on a golf club.
Everything comes to one and it gets there and it punches it through the air. Sweet as a nut.
Brilliant. Sweet as a nut indeed. Well, we're coming to the end of our DVD for this year. Brilliant tips and tactics from all the guys in the Matrix team. Les, particularly you coming into the studio today to talk through some brilliant things that people can pick up and move forwards with. If you've got anything to say to us, then you can get in touch through our Facebook page. But in the meantime, get out there, get on the bank, catch a few fish and let us know how you're going.